the biggest mistake a beginner can make is not referencing a null pointer or leaking memory. It's not learning how to use a debugger. If you aren't using a debugger yet, this video will probably be the most important video that I ever made, because searching for a bug without a debugger is like trying to mix colors with your eyes closed, and in this video, I will show you how to use a debugger with practical examples, but we will start with what's the right way of going about it, because it's equally important, and I'll show various techniques used by the best developers, so let's go! So when debugging, your purpose is to find what causes the problem. I know this sounds obvious, but probably the number one mistake is assuming you know what the problem is. Never assume you know what the problem is. So let me give you an example. You are making a game, and some texture isn't loaded for some reason. Looking at it, you might say, oh well, the texture isn't loaded. Let me check if that file is in the right place, and let me check if I named it properly. But from the texture being loaded, and it being displayed on the screen, there are hundreds of lines of code. The texture loading system might be the one that you are writing right now. But the bug could also be in displaying the texture, or it could be in sending the texture to be displayed. Of course, that doesn't mean that you can't trust your intuition. You just have to be careful when trying to figure out where a bug comes from. And here is where debugging comes into place. In this case, you find a way to check if the file is loaded, and then you check if the texture was properly sent to be rendered. So if the file was loaded and sent to the rendering engine, that means the bug is probably there. So the process of debugging is trying to narrow down the places where the problem is, and after you narrow it down to one line, you basically found the bug. And before I show you practical examples, I noticed that with time, your intuition skills will grow significantly to the point where you can pinpoint a hard bug from someone else's code just by looking at it. But please, keep in mind this quote, because if you guess wrong where the bug is, you'll waste time looking in the wrong place. Okay, now you'll see people printing stuff to the console to debug, and others looking down on them for not using a debugger. But the debugger is just a tool, and you just want to find the problem. Sometimes, printing things is the easiest way to debug. Let's look at a practical example. So I want to move this cube with my arrow keys, but it isn't moving. So from the moment you press the key to the cube moving, the bug could be in the key press itself, in the movement code, in the rendering code, or anywhere in between. So, does the key press button work? Well, let's find out by printing something here. Well, this addition surely has to work, but let's still print the position of our cube. You'll see why later. Finally, let's also print the position of our cube before we render it. And by pressing the keys, it seems like the cube moves properly. So it's the rendering code that isn't displaying it in the right place for some reason. But sometimes the bug can be weirder. In this example, even though I'm pressing the keys and updating the position, it still resets to zero before displaying the object. For this weird bug, you'll need to use a debugger. But I want to show you one more thing. So this is what I call stalling debugging. So we know that we set the variable correctly here, but somehow, here it is being reset to zero. So we know that something in the middle is messing with our variable. So let's remove everything there to see if that removes the bug. And would you look at that, the bug disappeared. So this is a very common way of debugging. Try to remove all possible failure points. Do the things as simple as possible to figure out where the bug is. At one point, I condensed my code so much that I brought it down to two identical lines of code. One was working, while the other wasn't working. How could that be? Well, one variable was a float, while the other was an int. And that was breaking the code. But I had to simplify my code and remove failure points as much as possible to find this bug. Getting back here, if we try to comment out only one function here, we will see that only this function is causing the problem. Now, in this case, I'm just writing to the variable. So this mistake was easy to spot, but a buffer overflow could also have the exact same effect. And it is very hard to spot. It can easily happen to overflow a buffer or wrongly cast a pointer and write over some other variables without you even touching them. So this is where the debugger comes in handy. So I will show you how to use the Visual Studio debugger, but your IDE probably also has a debugger, and they are all very similar. If you don't have a debugger, go install an IDE with a debugger now, because trust me, you need one. And if you want to use GDB, you have my permission as long as you can be productive with it. My experience with it is that I see beginners wanting to use it because they are on Linux, but in the end, they get no job done and don't get any useful information out of it. And that's why they avoid debuggers altogether. So please, do yourself a favor and install Visual Studio Code or something if you are on Linux. So, to debug, you have to be in debug mode. Release mode optimizes your code, and that means that the compiler will throw away almost all of your code, and that isn't very helpful when debugging. Now press F5 or this button to start the program and the debugging process. If your program crashes while you are debugging, you'll have the option to pause the execution of the program from there and see what caused the problem. So what the debugger allows you to do is to pause the execution and look inside your program. So you can just press this button to pause your program at any time. But that won't be very useful. It will pause in a random place that probably wasn't even written by you. So to pause the program at a specific place, you can put a breakpoint. You do this by clicking here, and after starting the debugger, the program will pause there. You can also press F11 to start your program from the beginning in pause mode. Then you have these three buttons here, that also have shortcuts. So you have step forward, step in, and step out. So step forward just goes to the next line, while step in goes inside the function. Step out goes outside the current function. And one more thing to note is that you will sometimes be moved in some weird code. That's because of some hidden function calls, like constructors or overloaded operators that also have to execute. If that happens, just step out of that function. Now, you also have this continue execution that will resume the normal execution of your program until you stop it or it reaches another breakpoint. So this can be useful if you want to quickly go over some sections. And finally, the call stack window allows you to see the functions that were called to get you to the current place. This is particularly useful when you enter the debugger from an error that was triggered and you want to understand where you are. Now, what can you do inside the debugger? Well, first of all, you can hover your mouse over variables and easily see what things they have inside and also change them. You can even see some more complex things. If you want to see multiple things at a time, you can use the watch window. Just type the name of your variable here. And check this out, you can even write C++ expressions here and they still work. You can easily get the address of a variable from here. Then, if you go inside the memory view, you can look inside the memory of the program. Now, every time a value changes, you'll be able to see it highlighted here. So this can be helpful, but doesn't update properly if you move very fast. So to find the bug from earlier in the video, we actually have a better tool. We can right-click here and select break when value changes. Then we can just let our program run normally, and it will stop when the value changes, finding you the bug. This thing works using the hardware actually. The CPU has a feature to watch when a variable changes, but it is also limited, so you can put this kind of break for only a few variables. And if you ever need to put a break inside a for loop at a certain iteration, you can also add conditions to breakpoints. Isn't that cool? And two final tips. If you ever want to put a breakpoint inside a place where you don't have anything, just declare a variable and assign a value to it, and you can put a breakpoint there. Also, to easily see the return value from a function like this, you can store it in a variable and return that variable so you can more easily hover over it. Now, if you do OpenGL, subscribe because I will do a video on debugging OpenGL soon. And trust me, you won't easily find the information that I'll show there. And if this video helped you, imagine how unstoppable you would be if you never had problems with C++ errors. So also go watch that video and share this one with a friend that also needs help. See you!